And after this, we'll study God's Word. In the book of Genesis, Jacob, when he was returning home, prayed to God, and he blessed the name of the Lord, saying, "When I was crossing this river, I had nothing but staff in my hand, but now I am two camps and all this multitude." Lord blessed him. Lord blessed him against all odds, because there was quite a few obstacles. There were some people who don't want Jacob to be blessed. But guess what? If Lord blesses you, nobody can stop it. I'm here to testify and to say we've been blessed. We've been blessed throughout the years of serving our Lord together. We've been blessed. I remember the time when Mountain was but one camp. Now there are two camps. One is across the river. Now we have two locations. One in Rainier is used by another body of believers. We have very good relationship with them because Lord, He's faithful. He's increasing us. But above all things, I'm grateful that He does increase us in the matter of souls and lives that are touched. This is true treasure. Bible says, naked we came into this world, naked we shall go. Guess what? Your favorite Nike is staying here. You're not going to take them with you. Her sister giggled because she walks barefoot. She's like, I'm already in, right? So, but the only things which has been done in the Lord will count. This is why in John chapter 15, Jesus said, apart from me, you can do nothing. And I can only imagine somebody saying, oh, just watch me, because we can do so many things. Well, the idea behind this text is this. Whatever is done apart from Him won't count. It won't amount to anything. Only things which are done in Jesus Christ will be of value. And today we're going to have an opportunity to do another thing in Christ, to give joyfully and wholeheartedly. I want to say thank you to all of you faithful givers, because who would know, but in the time of pandemic, we increased almost double in the giving area, and that must be God, because I hear negative reports all over the place and people losing their jobs. I don't know how it works. I don't question God. If He blesses, I'm there to receive it. So, but I know it is a blessing for us to give. Because of your faithful giving, carpets will be replaced in children's room, hopefully this week. There's some messy carpets. Parents, if you'd go and wash it, you probably want your child to go there. Just kidding. But we're about to replace them with new carpets. We have some other projects that needs to be done. But whatever we do, it's done with the purpose to accommodate the people of God, to have place, common grounds for us to come and to worship. Guess what? Many of you have learned through experience Zoom or Skype or any other platform won't substitute real fellowship. You gotta have that human touch, right? Gotta rub elbows and visit with one another and smell hot coffee in the morning or in the evening. So, yeah. So, ushers, please come forward. Let us all stand. We will pray. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord Jesus, today we want to stand alongside with your servant Jacob and to declare, Lord, you've blessed us in many ways. Our blessings are so multiple, so many, they cannot be counted. But for all things, we praise you. For every good and perfect gift comes from above, from the Father of light, in whom there is no shadow or variation of change. We love you, Jesus. Lord, and the greatest blessing of all is you. You are our portion. You are our reward. You are our true gain. And nothing in this world can be compared to obtaining you, to have you in our life. Thank you, Jesus, for enriching us with yourself. Apart from you, we would know what true love looks like, what true forgiveness looks like. We wouldn't even see value in forgiveness. But in you, Lord, we do understand that you blessed us with every blessing in heavenly places. We perceive, Lord, your kindness and your patience as great treasure. You open our eyes on riches that are not corruptible. And we bless your name for it. Thank you, Jesus. And amen, and amen, and come and give. Children, you are dismissed. You can go to your class. I said go. Don't run. Please do not run. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. I'd like to make several announcements. After service will be over with, on this tall table where Kelly stands right now, you will find a piece of paper which does look like this. They're not there now, but they will be there by the end of the service. And this is our schedule for hospitality tour. We're kicking it off this coming Friday, and it'll go on for 8 weeks. So for 8 weeks on the road, different members of the Church of Truth will open up their homes to host people of God. Come, bring your favorite dish with you. It would be better if you bring my favorite dish with you, but your favorite is fine. So, and we will enjoy it. Quite a few people enjoying it. Last time we've done it, we would have houses that are packed. You know, it was we would come not just to break bread, but to pray, to just follow the lead of the Holy Spirit. And some amazing things has happened on those tours. So a schedule will be on the table. Pick one up, you know, and show up. Please do. Okay. Tomorrow night we will have membership class here at 6:30. So if anybody interested to know, because if you will attend the class, it doesn't mean you have to become a member, but you will learn about what we stand for, what we believe in, because sometimes it takes years for people to go to certain church to find out what they're standing for. We had members of our church, people who joined the church over in Rainier, and they attended for 2 years, and then I spoke on the subject of Trinity. They got offended, and they left. And after this, I said, no, now we're going to discuss our beliefs ahead of time. So we will talk about our beliefs. We will talk about privileges and responsibilities of the members of the church. Privileges are few, responsibilities are many. But responsibilities, we view them as blessing, right? Hallelujah. In the kingdom of God, everything is reversed. While everybody is screaming for privilege in our society, right now, we ask for responsibilities. Lord, give us some so we can bear much fruit. Okay, so that's that. We will have our membership class. And what else? Tonight is the last. Well, let me put it right, two words. Tonight is our last 5 p.m. service. Starting next Sunday, our 5 p.m. service will be moved to 1 p.m. Okay? 1 p.m. So if you're going to show up here at 5 p.m., have church on the parking lot. We have nothing against this. You know, if you're persistent, there might be few of you, and maybe we have to start 5 p.m. service all over again for another bunch. But to make it clear, starting next Sunday, we have two back-to-back services, one at 10 a.m. and one at 1 p.m., okay? So I'll see you next Sunday at 1 p.m. here. Amen. Okay. Well, I rehearsed our history, short version of it, a few Sundays ago. But in 2006, after fasting and praying, Lord put on our heart to look for a location in Longview, Kelsa area, because we used to fellowship on the other side of the river. And I remember checking into the buildings, and I walk into what was called Victory Center, and I bump into Todd Cruz. You know, I ask him, how's everything? What's going on? We're looking for a building. And he's like, well, just come in. I'm like, okay, what do you mean by come in? You know, I think, well, how much we need to pay, what the rent will be. Well, just come in. This is the Lord's building. Well, that was strange to me. But this is how I start to learn how Mountain Ministry does operate. You know, let's just do it. And we came in, and I think we held one or two services. And after this, I've met with Gary and a few others, and we just decided to come together as a body. And it was a wonderful journey. It was a beautiful, beautiful thing. Lots of lives has been touched over in Kelsa, but then in the course of time, Lord brought us here, and we had this 6 p.m., then 5 p.m. services, and now it will be 1 p.m., so not much will change but the time, okay? So praise God. Okay, I think this is it when it comes to my announcement. Are you ready to receive incorruptible, everlasting, anointed Word of God? I'm about to read a lot. Today I'd like to talk to you on the subject of you being a sign of hope for this generation. I mean it. Lord set His people apart and called them light of the world and salt of the earth. When He did so, He intended for every believer to carry on with this light, so in a dark time, you can be as a sign that there is hope. Believe it or not, a lot of people right now losing their hope, and they're scared, they're terrified, they don't know what's coming. And it's not limited to one country. It's all over the world. All over the world, people captivated by fear, and it's perpetuated through every news channel over and over and over again. This is why it's a good idea to toss away your remote control, your mobile device, and to get into the Word of God. And you will find Word of hope, Word of restoration. You will read and you'll come out of your room different person. Hallelujah. For He did not give us spirit of fear, but spirit of power, love, and sound mind. And that means a lot, man. Sound mind, power, and love. Hallelujah. So our text can be found in Jeremiah chapter 32. Jeremiah chapter 32. I will start at the very beginning, and we're going to go through almost the entire chapter. Jeremiah chapter 32, verse 1. The word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord in the 10th year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, which was the 18th year of Nebuchadnezzar. For then the king of Babylon's army besieged Jerusalem, and Jeremiah the prophet was shut up in the court of the prison, which was in the king of Judah's house. For Zedekiah, king of Judah, had shut him up, saying, "Why do you prophesy and say, 'Thus says the Lord, behold, I'll give the city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall take it'?" Like, why, Jeremiah? Why you speak bad about me, Jeremiah? Why can't you speak well of me? Well, Zedekiah was not the only king who was at odds with prophets of God. You see, powerful people of this world don't want you to speak negative of them. By the way, at our day and time, even if you try to leave negative comment about some of the leaders right now, Facebook and Instagram will instantly block it, because all that they want to hear is praise, praise, and praise. So here we have similar situation, nothing new under the heaven, right? You know, here we have Zedekiah, and he tossed Jeremiah into the prison, and he's like, "Why do you prophesy bad about me? Why do you prophesy and say, 'Thus says the Lord, behold, I'll give this city into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall take it. And Zedekiah, king of Judah, shall not escape from the hand of Chaldeans, but shall surely be delivered into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he shall speak with him face to face and see him eye to eye. Then shall lead Zedekiah to Babylon, and there he shall be until I visit him, says the Lord. Though you fight with Chaldeans, you shall not succeed." So all of this is prophecy of Jeremiah to Zedekiah. Zedekiah was the son of Josiah. His original name, by the way, Josiah was a very good king. If you'll study your Bible, you'll find out he's the one to him whom Bible give description that there was none like him before him or after him. There was none. Nevertheless, you will find in the same chapter, because of the sins of Manasseh, God did not remove the judgment from Israel. See, there was times when God said, "Enough is enough." I mean, he's patient, he's long-suffering, but sometimes his long-suffering confused with his absence. In one of the Psalms, God said, "You've been doing this, and I kept silent, and you decided that I am altogether just like you are." Sometimes the silence of God, interpreted as confirmation for wicked doings, or as his absence altogether. God was patient with Israel, but then he said, because of the sins of Manasseh, I'm going to bring the kingdom of Israel to an end. So Zedekiah was the son of Josiah. His original name was Mattaniah, but when Nebuchadnezzar placed him on the throne as the successor of Jehoiakim, his brother, he changed his name to Zedekiah. Despite the strong warnings of Jeremiah and others, he threw off the yoke of Babylon and entered into an alliance with Hophra, king of Egypt. This brought Nebuchadnezzar to the walls of the city of Jerusalem. Here's some interesting story. It's well-based Bible-based story with some historic elements, with some extra-biblical elements. During the reign of Zedekiah, two prophets prophesied. Jeremiah, who prophesied in the city of Jerusalem, and Ezekiel, who prophesied in captivity. One of them, that is Jeremiah, just as we've read, prophesied that Zedekiah will be captured by king of Babylon. He will see him face to face and eyes to eyes, and he'll be led into the city of Babylon. But Ezekiel prophesied that he will be taken captive but never will see the city of the Babylon. There was time, and you will find this in the book of Jeremiah, when Zedekiah, after hearing some of the prophecies of Jeremiah, had apparent change of heart. But when he compared these two prophecies and he saw them as contradicting one another, he tossed them both away and continued on in his wickedness. But here is the outcome. When Nebuchadnezzar, tongue-twisting name, besieged the city, and when the walls of the city was finally breached, Zedekiah tried to escape with his sons and with some of the nobles of the land. Yet they were captured in the field and brought before King Nebuchadnezzar. His sons were executed before his very own eyes. And after this, Nebuchadnezzar plucked out both of his eyes and led him into the city of Babylon. Thus, both of the prophecies were fulfilled. He never saw the Babylon, yet he was led into Babylon. And I think the moral of the story is this: you got to do right thing, because right thing is the right thing to do. It's deep thought right there. Because he was about to do it, but then they disagree among themselves. I'll continue on my path. I have nothing to be afraid of. No, you just got to do right thing. You see, God cannot be mocked. Both of the prophecies came through. Let us continue in Jeremiah chapter 32. And Jeremiah said, "The word of the Lord came to me. Behold, Hanamel, the son of Shallum, your uncle, will come to you, saying, 'Buy my field, which is in Anathoth, for the right of redemption is yours to buy it.' Then Hanamel, my uncle's son, came to me in the court of the prison, according to the word of the Lord, and said to me, 'Please buy my field that is in Anathoth, which is in the country of Benjamin, for the right of inheritance is yours.'" You've got to appreciate the story. We have Jeremiah, who's in jail. He's behind the bars. At this time, the king of Babylon, right on the other side of the city of Jerusalem, and the land which was about to be offered to Jeremiah, right now trampled under the foot of Babylonians. And he come to Jeremiah with an intent to sell, or so Jeremiah can redeem this parcel. The right is yours. Buy it. He probably thought, we all know Jeremiah is out of his mind, and I do need some gold and silver in my pocket, because they all prepared to be led into captivity. So he's coming to Jeremiah and he's offering to Jeremiah to buy the land. "Please buy my field that is in Anathoth, which is in the country of Benjamin, for the right of inheritance is yours and the redemption yours. Buy it for yourself." Then Jeremiah said, "Then I knew that this was the word of the Lord. So I bought the field from Hanamel, the son of my uncle, who was in Anathoth, and waged out to him the money, 17 shekels of silver. And I signed the deed and sealed it, took witnesses, and weighed the money on the scale. So I took the purchase deed, both that which was sealed according to the law and custom, and that which was open. And I gave the purchase deed to Baruch, the son of Nira, son of Maaseiah, in the presence of Hanamel, my uncle's son, and in the presence of the witnesses who signed the purchase deed before all the Jews who sat in the court of the prison. Then I charged Baruch before them, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, take these deeds, both this purchase deed, which is sealed, and this deed, which is open, and put them in earthen vessel, that they may last many days. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, houses and fields and vineyards shall be possessed again in this land. Now when I had delivered the purchase deed to Baruch, the son of Neriah, I prayed to the Lord, saying, ah, Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you. You show loving kindness to thousands and repay the iniquity, and etc. He just goes on and praising the Lord for a few more verses just to set the stage for following statement. Verse 23, and they came and took possession of it, but they have not obeyed your voice or walked in your law. They have done nothing of all that you commanded them to do, that is Israelites. Therefore you have caused all this calamity to come upon them. Look, the siege mounts. They have come to the city to take it, and the city has been given into the hand of the Chaldeans, who fight against this because of the sword and famine and pestilence. What you have spoken has happened. There, you see it, and you have said to me, O Lord, buy the field with money and take witness, yet the city has been given into the hand of Chaldeans. You know what I appreciate about Jeremiah here? First, he obeyed, and then he asked questions. Oftentimes I see this in reverse. Why should I? It doesn't make sense. Lord, do you really mean we have to separate from the world? You know, do you really mean that you hate divorce, oh Lord? People come and ask, Lord, all sorts of questions. On Jeremiah's part, no question has been asked until obedience were completed. And once obedience were completed, he came and like, Lord, you have to do some explanation here. Here is the deed, but the siege is mount. Chaldeans about to break through, and you telling me, go and buy the land? Do you have an answer for this? Yes, Lord does have answers for all things. Then the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah, saying, behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? That's what we call rhetorical question. We know the answer, that there is nothing too hard for the Lord, right? Anything too hard for me? Therefore, thus says the Lord, behold, I'll give the city into the hand of Chaldeans, into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and he shall take it. And the Chaldeans who fight against the city shall come and set fire to the city and burn it, with houses on whose roofs they have offered incense to Baal and poured out drink offering to other gods to provoke me to anger. Now, therefore, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, concerning the city of which you say it shall be delivered into the hand of king of Babylon by the sword, by the famine, and by pestilence. Behold, I'll gather them out of all countries where I have driven them in my anger, in my fury, and in great wrath. I'll bring them back to this place, and I'll cause them to dwell safely. They shall be my people, and I will be their God. Then I'll give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever, for the good of them and their children after them. And I'll make an everlasting covenant with them. Do you see this? While judgment is not complete yet, God already does have plan how to return them and how to redeem them. And I'll make everlasting covenant with them. And there's only one everlasting covenant that I know of. The one that is based on the blood of Jesus Christ. There is no other everlasting covenant. I will make an everlasting covenant with them that I'll not turn away from doing them good, but I'll put my fear in their hearts so that they will not depart from me. Yes, I will rejoice over them to do them good, and I'll surely plant them in this land with all my heart and with all my soul. And the fields will be bought in this land of which you say it is desolate, without man or beast. It has been given into the hands of Chaldeans. Men will buy fields for money, sign deeds and seal them, and take witness in the land of Benjamin, in the places around Jerusalem, in the cities of Judah, in the cities of mountains, in the city of lowland, and in cities of the south. For I will cause their captives to return, says the Lord. Whew, that was lots of reading, right? I guess there's a lot to learn in this story, but let me start with this. Fear is contagious. Bible says, that there is pain. Fear is a dreadful thing. There's pain in it. Fear does spread like wildfire. There's torment in fear. Courage, even though it's rare, it gives hope. And it can annihilate or destroy fear. One of the well-known stories in the Bible is the story of David and Goliath. No matter how many times I hear the story, I'm still rejoicing in hearing it. And I'm also rejoicing in sharing it. Today, I'd like to offer you a brief version. Remember when the army of Israel and the army of Philistines stood in the battle array against one another? Philistines championed their Goliath. They sent him forth, and he said, "Give me men to fight." And the dude was huge, and all of his weaponry was huge. Big, he was intimidating, and everybody, starting with Saul and all of his mighty men, were afraid. They were scared to fight this man. Well, it lasted for 40 days. For 40 days, he would come, and each time, I assume, he was more and more obnoxious. He would defy the army of Israel. He would curse the God of Israel. But with each day, fear only grew. They were terrified. They were scared. And now fear became norm. Nobody questioning it anymore, because we're doing it for 40 days now, and we're good at it. Here comes Goliath, right? And now it's time to hide. And all of a sudden, there is fresh blood on the ground. I mean, fresh young men. You know, he came to visit with his brothers, and he brought them some cheese and some other stuff, you know. And he happened to come right at the time when Goliath came forth and started to blaspheme and defy the army of Israel and the Lord of Israel. And here's what's interesting to me. The Lord God Almighty could quench his breath, I mean take his breath away from him at the blink of an eye. Yet he chose not to do it. He was looking for men after his heart. You see, fear is contagious. They all in the grip of fear, and there's nothing to change. Except now, young men in the field, and he's like, "Who's this Philistine? You know, what he's doing here? Can't you guys hear what he's saying? Like, come on." And guess what? His older brother, telling him to go home. I know your arrogant heart. You left this few sheep of yours. Just go home. I know who you are. And David like, well, it's just words. I'm just asking. But he turned around and he started to ask some other people. Like, what was that that Saul said he will do to men who will defeat this giant? And the promise was this. Whoever will defeat Saul, his father's house will be tax-free. They won't pay any tax. And the daughter of the king would be given into a marriage, would be given to this hero who will defeat Goliath. I mean, he got me on taxes, man. You know, I would go and fight just to be tax-free. You know, so David checked with few, and after saying was confirmed, he presented himself before Saul. I'm going to fight him. At this time, Bible giving him description as a young man. He have not quite formed yet to be a man or warrior. You see, he wasn't even one of the army of Saul. He was a little shepherd boy, but he was a little guy with attitude the size of Texas man. Or maybe I should say Alaska. You know, he had lots of attitude, and he's like, I'll fight. And Saul is so desperate. First he said, well, you're only a youth, but this man is warrior from his youth. And David like, well, that's not big of a deal because, you know, there was bear and there was lion and they would come to steal my sheep and I'll go after them and Lord would deliver them into my hand. And it's like, who's this guy? So for Saul, it was really, it's like, that's my only hope. He gave to David his armor. And Bible says David put it on and he walked back and forth and he's like, I'm not accustomed to this. This is weird. It didn't help you. How in the world it should help me? You know, take your staff back. I'm going to do it my way. And his way was to do it in the name of the Lord. He went to the brook and find 5 smooth stones. You know the story, right? And he took his sling. And next day when Goliath stepped forward, he saw something unusual. I mean, he was anticipating yet another day of mockery, of parading himself over the troops of Israel, you know, but it was not his day. Because all of a sudden, young boy comes with the staff in his hand and with the sling. And he's like, who are you? You know, am I a dog? You came to fight me with the stick? And now be ready for trash talk. You know, they think it's an invention of nowadays. Now it's been around for a while. And by the way, David was pretty good at trash talk. You know, he said, I'm going to kill you and I'm going to feed you. This is Goliath to David, to the birds of the air, to the beasts of the field. David like, wait, I'm going to kill you and all this army and I'm going to feed you and your boat. I mean, he's like, not just you, Goliath, but you and the entire army of Philistines. Today I will feed to the birds of the field, to the beasts of the air. And as giant pursued or came forth, David ran toward him and whew, the hand of the Lord, man. Bible says that this stone found its place. I mean, he had helmet. Goliath had helmet on. And somehow this stone managed to sink into his forehead. And he fell down dead. If that would happen in nowadays, they would tell us that Goliath died of COVID. Because in the last few moments of his life, he felt a little dizzy at his hand, and being dizzy is one of like 200 symptoms of COVID. It's like whatever symptom you have, it's like COVID right now. But let me tell you this, Goliath didn't die of COVID. Goliath did die because the hand of God guided the stone which was sent by courageous men of God. And guess what? When it happened, everybody stood up. and they start to chase Philistines, and the victory of this day was great, and fear was no more because of the courageous act of one man. I bet by the end of the day, they were kicking themselves like, man, that could be me, because now David's house will be free or tax exempt, and he's gonna get king's girl. They had no clue what David's life going to look like alongside with King Saul. But guess what? The courage of one man. The courage of one man. Courage is rare, but it can stop fear. Now we live in a generation that is gripped by fear. And as I already stated, fear is perpetuated. We're going to have dark winter. We're going to see more people dying. Oh, no, it's just... and all sorts of tensions in the world. All of a sudden, people talking about World War III. People losing their peace. People losing their sleep. But it is not so with the elect of God, because we have received kingdom which cannot be shaken, and it won't pass away. Our kingdom won't be shaken, and it won't go away. Amen? And God sets you apart to be courageous men or women of God, and to be a sign of hope for people, that they would know that there is hope. There is hope. There is place of peace, place of stability, place of restoration, and it is in His presence. Hallelujah. I live to see the collapse of the Soviet Union from within. Growing up, I thought this monster will stand forever. But guess what? In the beginning of the last century, everything that we hear and see now here has happened in Russia. Cancel culture. Everything that happened before us is bad. We're going to build a new and good world. We're going to distribute wealth properly. We're going to come and build a new world, and nobodies will become somebodies or everybody. And it was bloodbath. It was a horrible thing. You see, one of the traits that you cannot separate from socialism is godlessness. Socialist is godless by definition. They're anti-God because government is their God. Government, they put their trust in men. Church was persecuted. God was denied. It has happened for 70 years. And then country collapsed. Fall apart. And I remember walking on the streets of my village, and back then I, even though as part of the family of believers, I myself, and I believed in God, I didn't serve Him though. And I wish I did. Because I remember walking once on the central street of our city, and our PE teacher coming my way. And country is in desperation because we've been told everything before communists came to power was bad. Now we learn that the communists are somehow bad. People are losing hope. The suicide is through the roof. You know, there's depression, there's inflation, there's all sorts of things. And he's approaching me and he said, like, Leo, can you talk to me about God? You see, they knew that we were from the family of believers, and it was rare find because church was underground, believers were oppressed, and during persecution, church reduced to its actual size. Church is never bigger than in the time of persecution. It can have appearance of being bigger, but persecution will reduce the church to its actual size. So there was few of us, and he's approaching me because he knows I am from the family of believers, and I didn't go through the stages of dedication to become young communist, etc. You know, I did this because of my parents' conviction, but I myself like, okay, well, God exists. He's like, well, now we all know He exists, but can you tell me more about God? Unfortunately, I wasn't able to tell him more about God at the time. Shortly after, we moved to United States of America. Here in United States of America, in the city of Longview, Jesus got hold of me. And I'm glad He did. I was contemplating on it a lot, but coming to United States, for me, it was a way of escape from my friends, from the circle of... And some of you probably know how hard it is to break away from your friends. But if they're dragging you back into the world, do it, man. Don't hesitate. You know, fortunately for me, Lord moved me halfway across the world so I can start to look into the Bible, and all of a sudden the Word of God speaks to me, and I see this as blueprints for my life, which has been neglected by me through a large portion of my life now. On my first trip to Kyrgyzstan, I'm searching for my PE teacher. I'm finding his apartment because I knew where he lived. He lived on the fourth floor of apartment, and the reason why I remember this, we had to carry piano to the fourth floor. His wife was a musician. You know, what a task it was. And I'm knocking at the door, but someone else opened, and they said, he's not living here anymore. He moved to Russia. I only hope that my PE teacher found someone who had ability to lead him to the Lord. I only hope he never stopped searching. But I wish it was me. But what I'm trying to tell you right now, you will have this experience. You will come across people who will be losing their hope. Because when everything is shaken, and everything that can be shaken will be shaken, this is the promise which is written on the pages of the Bible. You will stand because you are not of this world. Amen? Jeremiah. Jeremiah was... I have appreciation for Jeremiah. Jeremiah had a rough life. Jeremiah is one of my favorite prophets. For 40 years, he has prophesied and he watched his country being on decline. He didn't perform a single miracle, sign, or wonder, but he was faithful to his calling. To the end, he was crying out to the city of Israel, turn around, repent. They tortured him. They threw him into the mud pit, and he was spent few days in the mud up to his waist. It's not fun, trust me. You know, he was jailed. They threatened to poison him. Even his brothers, his family turned against him. And in his early ministry, he's questioning God. But finally, he's like, this is who I am. This is what I do. I am the man of God. And now God telling him ahead of time, your cousin will come to you and offer that you'd buy the parcel of land. And he's in jail, right? Jeremiah is in jail. And the parcel of land is under Chaldeans at the moment. How many would like to make such investment? It's like, well, if God says so. But God says so. And Jeremiah buying it. He's buying it. And after deal is sealed, he's talking to God like, Lord, what it's all about? And God said, I want you to be a sign of hope. The day will come and the land will be for sale again. And the fields will be for sale and the homes will be built. And I will sing over my people. I'll make a new covenant with them. But I want you to be a sign of hope. You see, Jeremiah always been man of the next chapter. When everybody cried out and said, peace and prosperity, he was prophesying gloom and doom. But when gloom and doom starts to happen, he's buying a piece of land. He's living ahead of time. And guess what? Lord wants us to be people of the next chapter. Because we already know the end of the book. We already know the outcome. And we have nothing to worry about. Amen? I mean, you just have to resolve in your heart. No matter what. My portion is my God. And this portion of mine cannot be taken away from me. You see, if our portion in this world, it's just a matter of time and Satan will find his way to harass you, to threaten you, and to set you on fear. But if your treasure is in the Lord, it's beyond his reach. You're just here to be a sign of hope. Hallelujah. Jeremiah was a sign of hope for his generation. Guess what? He never saw the return to the land of Israel. It takes 70 years. It took 70 years for Israelites to come back. This is why the Bible says that many of them did not obtain the promise. That not without us they would reach perfection. But he was there just to say, or to state, there's hope. In any time, call upon the name of the Lord and be saved. There's hope, man. In any time, in any season, there is hope. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 15 through 16. And I'm going to wrap up with this passage. 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 15 through 16. For we are to God the fragrance of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. To the one we are aroma of death leading to death, and to the other the aroma of life leading to life. And who is sufficient for this? Thanks. Lord gave us very illustrious position in this world. To some, we're aroma of death. You see, Christ himself said, they persecuted me, they persecute you also. They hated me, they will hate you also. But he also said, they listened to me and they will listen to you as well. To some, we're aroma of death. Some look at the church right now as at the stronghold, bulwark of conservative values. Many people do not realize that the values which we call conservative are actually Bible-based values. Not that long ago, I had a conversation with someone who suggested that all Christians should be conservative. And I said, no, for us to become conservative is to take a step down. He was a little surprised. What do you mean? You liberal? Like, no. Please do not be afraid of this word. We're dogmatic. On some of the issues, not on all of them. Because conservative people do change, and we've seen it. We see how conservative people change their values. Before I knew the Lord, I was conservative. But when it was convenient for me, I would change my ways because it was rooted in me. But when I came to know the Lord, whatever the Lord says goes, and there was no discussion about this. This is what I call dogmatic. Listen to this. I mean, we're not dogmatic on every issue, but essential issues we are. How many genders are there? And there is no room for discussion there, right? But what if somebody feel like who cares? Bible says so. There's only two genders. You know, what about fetus? What about, is that a child or just blob of tissue? It's a child. And there was no room for argument here because God spoke to Jeremiah saying, before you ever been born, I knew you. Some say life start with conception. God says life start long before conception, because before he was conceived, God already knew him. You see, there are some values we cannot compromise. There was no room for us to compromise. And this is why, for some, your aroma of death. They're like, Christians. No, you're laughing right now. But right now, I think there is nothing. President Trump, in a way, served as a cushion between. You remember that the last directive of President Obama was for men to use woman's restroom or locker room if he feel a woman at the moment, and vice versa. You know, it's like, for me, it was like seeing a nightmare. I want to pinch myself. Like, is that for real? Yeah, it's for real. I mean, the man who occupied the highest office in the land, who ran for office on conservative, he was pro-marriage, pro-traditional marriage, just because he won some votes. There's a bunch of liars there, you know. And nobody can block me on this platform from saying this. You know, and right now, I think Satan will come with vengeance on his church. So besides all of the turmoil that we will see in the world, they will try to regain the time that was lost. And we already hear some obnoxious statements. Not that long ago, one of the churches in California was bombed just because they choose to keep their doors open, which makes you a pretty good target, because they call this gathering super spreaders right now. But if we're spreading anything, we're spreading sweet aroma of God according to this passage. To some, it's smell of death. They're terrified, but to some, it's smell of hope. And believe me, there's many, many. I mean, this Sunday morning, this place was pretty packed. Because right now, people are looking for, and new people come, and I'm warning them, like, if you will see this gathering as being weird, it's not on us. You guys bringing it in. Because all people from all kind of walks, all of a sudden, denomination and doctrinal stuff become secondary. They're just looking for church that discern, which does discern, that the fellowship is essential. It's essential for us. It's ordered by our King that we would come together. We would come together. It's essential. And what a convenient thing, pandemic. By the way, there's no pandemic. If you look up the definition, pandemic, I mean, if pandemic does have 99.4 survival rate, it's not pandemic. It's a gimmick. And they work it because it's convenient to subdue the nation. And above all things, I believe it's targeted against the church. Don't get me wrong. There is COVID. COVID is real. You know, we're praying for a few people who hospitalized right now. But there is no pandemic. This issue will be perpetuated. Because guess what? I talked to a friend of mine from Salem, Oregon. And he told me that the pastor of the 500 members strong decided to let his members go, and he closed the church. Not everybody can endure this kind of pressure. You see, some are in because it's entertaining or profitable. We're in because we love the Lord. And we have calling upon our life to spread sweet aroma of the knowledge of Jesus Christ among the people that we're living in. He set us apart to be a sign, to be a wonder, that there is hope. There is kingdom which cannot be shaken. And this kingdom is the kingdom of God. Let us all stand.
Myself at your feet, last can you won't you me? Won't you meet me? Can I do it on my own? Can I do it all alone? Here I am. Can you want me? Won't you meet me? Can I do it on my own? Not to it all alone. Here I am. Here I am. All tonight. With my arms open wide. Won't you come? Come and fill this heart of mine. I'm in need of you. Love your touch, of your life, of your love. I lay myself at your feet. Asking you, won't you meet me? Won't you meet me? Won't you meet me?
Lord, this night we want to say once again, thank you very much for placing our feet on a foundation which cannot be shaken. Let us have attitude of Jeremiah. No questions asked. Just obedience. We want to be obedient to your call in this season and all seasons of our life. We love you, Lord. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And the Spirit and the Bride say, come, 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 come. Amen. Please be seated. I want to ask Brother Mike to come. He does have some word that he'd like to share.
Thank you. This morning, Pastor preached a very powerful message on sonship, on a mutual responsibility of both God's expectation of the Father and the responsibilities of the Father, and also the expectation of how the Son ought to revere and respect and receive. And the only way that the fullness of the fruit of what God intended for that relationship to look like, it's important that both parties play their role in that covenant relationship. And tonight, I didn't know that this was the direction that Pastor was preaching in. When I asked him that I wanted to share, he asked me, is the thing that you want to share of the same content? And I had no idea of the content.
It changed at the last moment, brother.
But here's the thing. God foresees, God foreknows, and it was even more fitting, the content was even more fitting that you talked about tonight, which only confirmed what the Lord wanted me to speak. After this message, I really began to reflect, because it's Scripture says, you know, fathers, don't provoke your children to wrath, lest they become discouraged, but train them up, raise them up in the admonition of the Lord. And I was just really considering, you know, the way that I'm raising up not just my own physical children, but the spiritual children that God has given me. How am I raising them up? How sometimes my responses to my son's disobedience is, again, with my own disobedience, because I'm not responding to him with a spiritual response. I'm responding to him in a carnal response. I'm responding to him in a fleshly manner, through frustration, through being irritated and agitated at his unwillingness to yield or be obedient. And so it brought me under, you know, a lot of conviction about how important it is to me, because of my love for him, how much I want to pass on this rich heritage, this amazing inheritance that God has given. And I began to reflect on these other children. I have many kids. I have kids that are having kids that are older than my youngest. And as I begin to reflect on them throughout the day, On the way here, actually, I was sharing a bit with Robbie about just asking for the men of God, the people who know me, to be lifting me up and praying that I would be able to have the wisdom, have the discernment to know the right kinds of responses when these conflicts come. And as I was reflecting on these other kids, the Lord spoke a word into my heart. And he said, in my thoughts towards my other kids, because I have little to no relationship with them currently. And the Lord said to me was this. He said, you have accepted the death of these relationships as casualties of war. But my intent is to raise them from the dead. And the Lord, as Leo began to preach, the Lord began to speak to me about the rite of redemption. And the rite of redemption is mine for these children. That this land that right now is being occupied by the enemy, see, they're not walking with God. Right now, this land is being occupied by the Chaldeans. This land is being occupied by a place of captivity. And the Lord's saying, buy into the prophetic word of God. Buy into the things that you hear in the quiet, secret places. Preach it from the housetop. That you're to be a sign of hope to this generation. And this morning, in Matthew 7, 9, Leo was preaching from this place. If a son asks his father for a loaf of bread, would he give him a stone? And most of you know this parable. He says, if you ask of something, will he give you a snake? Or if he asks for an egg, will he give him a serpent? And I never looked at this passage quite like this before. But I thought, Lord, what I'm going to ask for is not for me. I'm going to ask for the Holy Spirit, because it says, if you being evil know how to give your children good gifts, how much will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? And so in my asking this morning, I asked, Lord, give your Holy Spirit to my son, Christian. And give your Holy Spirit to my son, Jade. And give your Holy Spirit to my daughter, Noelle. And give your Holy Spirit to my daughter, Legend. And give your Holy Spirit to my son, Arrow. And give your Holy Spirit to Price and Abel and Grace and Judah. Give your Holy Spirit. And he says, you ask me of my spirit, I'm not going to give you a scorpion. I'm not going to give you a snake. I'm not going to give you a stone. I'm going to give you the very thing that you're asking for. And so in faith, I am laying hold of the promises of God. God speaks these prophetic things to me to reach out and lay hold of it because he's done it before, because I've seen him do it before. And I take these things and I write down the things in a journal. I keep a book of the treasures of God, of the things that God has said to me, so that when times get hard, I don't forget who my God is. And those things have been taught to me by other men of God, by other people of God that tell me, look, it's important that the time that you spend with the Lord, it's important to get alone with God, to listen to God. But it's important to write down the things that the Holy Spirit says to you, because if God says something to you, God is not a liar. That's what he spoke to Jeremiah. He said, listen, by this field, believe now in this prophetic word, even though you cannot yet see it with your eyes. All you see is a siege mound. All you see right now is captivity, but trust in the prophetic word of the Lord, and you'll see it come to pass. So, again, I'm asking for your prayer that indeed that I would be able to hear the voice of the Lord in spite of when I'm trying to train up my child or my children in the way that they should go, not to be disillusioned with the captivity that I think that I see. Because this is what God says, if the lump is holy, the seed will be holy also. This child was born in a covenant of the Lord. And so what I know is he belongs to the Lord. He belongs to God. God's already laid his hand on him. But I wanted to speak that word of encouragement. The word of God says to comfort others with the comfort by which you've been comforted. And I just felt like the Lord gave me another anchor to lay hold of and hold on to, and to be able to look into the future with a hope and a promise, because that's who our God is. Whether my eyes ever see it or whether they don't, I'm going to go on trusting and believing that God is going to do the very thing that he gave to me today. Amen? Bless you guys.
Let's pray for the right of redemption.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Father, I pray for the right of redemption, God, that this land that you have committed to us, God, that everywhere that there are sons and daughters, I pray that in the hearts of the fathers and the mothers, that they would indeed believe in the right of redemption, that this is my heritage, that you gave these children to me in the natural, and then in the same way that you've given them to me in the natural, I believe that you've given to me in the spirit, Lord. And so in the spirit, I receive them into the kingdom of heaven. I'm calling them forth from death into life, even now. Even as I'm standing here, I'm calling each one of them by name into the kingdom of heaven. And I am believing that Almighty God is going to perform his word, the same word that we heard tonight through Jeremiah, to buy this field, to buy the prophetic word, to believe in the word of the living God, and that we would see it come to pass. Lord, I thank you for the little mustard seed of faith that you put in me. And I thank you, Lord, that you've nurtured it and that you've watered it. And I pray that in my being obedient to what the Spirit has asked me to do and come up and testify, that seed tonight would be indeed multiplied, Lord. Many times may it be multiplied. May it be planted and sown into the hearts of others who hear it, Lord. May it be watered by your Spirit. And may we continue to water it and bathe those prophetic words in prayer, believing, interceding over those things that you've said this, Lord. And because you've said it, I'm going to continue to water it. You planted a seed in my heart, and I'm going to believe, and I'm going to pray believing. And so, Lord, even now, I want to pray believing not only for the right of redemption of my own children, but that right of redemption for all the children of the ones that are being represented by the people here, Lord. That for the kingdom of heaven, that they would be laid hold of in faith tonight. That we would believe salvation for every one of them, that not one would be lost. That not one would be lost. That in the same way that Jesus said, every one of them that you've given to me, I've kept. And I pray in faith we would keep every one for the day of salvation, Lord. We send your people out with blessing. We send your people out with blessing, with life and light and truth and hope in their hearts. And I pray that every one of us would be that message of hope, just like Pastor was talking about, Lord, that we would be the message of hope, that we would be the message of light and life in this generation, Lord. knowing that this is our opportunity to bring you the most glory and the most honor and the most praise in the way that we live out our faith for the rest of our days, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Children got excited at the word amen. God bless y'all. Please remember next time we're going to meet at 1 p.m. And the schedule for hospitality tour is already on the table, so...